Looking at our world from a theological perspective. This is the Theology Central Podcast, making theology central.
Good morning, everyone. It is Friday, July the 16th, 2021. It is currently 11:21 a.m. Central Time, and I'm coming to you from the sanctuary of Victory Baptist Church, located right here in the middle of nowhere, Texas. And even though I'm coming to you from the middle of nowhere, Texas, because of technology, the one amazing thing is, even though this is a little church, insignificant, if you were to drive by it, you'd probably just laugh at it. We're here. We're nobody. We're in the middle of nowhere. I'm stressing that. We're in the middle of nowhere. I mean, again, look up Ovalo, Texas. Pull up Google Maps, Google Earth, look up Ovalo, Texas. You're going to be like, wait, who would put a church there? It's literally in the middle of nowhere. Even though that's where we are located, but one of the great things is I can turn on a microphone, hit a big red go live button, and then I can broadcast live all around the world via the internet. And then that episode is then taken and then sent to every podcasting platform on the face of the planet. And then people can discover and listen. And hopefully we can provide them some thought-provoking content, some spiritually edifying spiritual food, and that we can be beneficial and minister to people. Even though we're in a situation where we may appear to be insignificant, we can still try to accomplish as much as we can with the technology. Using the technology, I think, is so vitally important right now. Christians need to be using that technology. I've always said that. I don't understand why pastors don't use the technology. I'm always just baffled by it. It's like, okay, well, you preach, wonderful. Now, but don't you have more to say? Isn't there more to discuss, more to teach? Use the technology available to you and get the message out there. But when you get the message out there, that it's awesome that people all around the world hear you, but you also then get another opportunity. You get an opportunity to then try to answer questions, provide studies and things for people who contact you. People will email you and say, hey, what about this? Hey, can you help me with this? Could you do a study on this passage? Hey, I don't understand this. Then you can do an additional level of trying to minister to people by turning on the microphone and answering those questions. And that's what we're going to do in this episode. I'm going to turn on this microphone. Well, obviously it's on because I'm live on the air. And I'm going to try to answer a question that I received. And let me pull up the email. When did I receive this? I received this on July the 15th, yesterday, at 7:44 a.m. At 7:44 a.m. Now, I apologize because the goal was to come out here yesterday afternoon and try to address this question. I did not get to it because of things I've already talked about in the last live broadcast. We won't spend any time reviewing that. But here I am today, so a little more than 24 hours later, here I am, and I'm going to do my very best to address this issue. So I'm going to read to you the email, and then we're going to jump right in, and hopefully I can do something that will be beneficial. All right, here's the email. Can you speak on this topic, tattoos? If you think the Bible addresses it, and if it does, what is your interpretation? Thanks for all your teachings. Well, thank you for listening. That's the most important thing. Thank you for listening. And thank you for feeling like, now, you never know when someone asks you a question. You never know. You're always like, okay, so let's see. They're going to ask me a question about tattoos. Now, is this a person sitting there typing out the email and they've got a full sleeve of tattoos? And like, well, I wonder what he's going to say. Is it a situation where, okay, I like him, but if he answers this question wrong, then I'm never listening to him again, right? Because you never know. You get a question, you don't know. You don't know, like, okay, yeah, I see. I wonder how they want me to answer this. Now, if you know me, you know I'm not going to answer any question based off what I think people want to hear. I'm going to answer the question, as honest as I can, whether people like it or not. So I don't know. I don't know the situation here, but someone's asking a question about tattoos. And so we're going to do our best to answer it. But we're not going to answer this by just immediately. I know I could just turn on the microphone and go, okay, here's this verse in Leviticus. And we could just immediately go there. We will get to the verse in Leviticus because that's where everybody goes. We will get to the verse in Leviticus, try to understand it in its historical context, and try to see how it applies today. But I think a question about tattoos really, there's a deeper subject here. All right. I always like to go, like, I always see a question, but I always like to look at the issues that are below. Like, here's the question, but there's always more. There's always something beyond the question that I think we need to consider. Right. And so I want you to think about this. I've been talking about this a lot lately, so I'm just going to use this as another opportunity to do so. If you've been a Christian for any length of time, you should catch on. If you haven't caught on yet, I don't know what's taking you so long, but you should realize very quickly that there is something called Christianity and there is something called churchianity. And Christianity and churchianity, look, you may disagree, but I think I can prove that I'm right. Christianity and churchianity are two very different things. Christianity is found in the pages of the Bible. Christianity is about Christ and the Word of God. Churchianity is where you take fallible, sinful human beings, we take Christianity, and then we put this inside what we call a church, and we begin to shape it, mold it, and it evolves into something in many cases that is no longer really resembles Christianity. Christianity and churchianity sometimes are in conflict with one another. And a lot of people realize this. They're like, look at what the church does. That doesn't appear to be Christianity. And you're right in many cases. And the reason this happens is because everyone involved in Christianity, the one speaking into this microphone and the people hearing what's coming out on the other side, we're all fallible sinners. We all are messed up human beings. And Christians,
there are three things that Christians do to Christianity, all right? There are three things that Christians bring into Christianity, which creates churchianity, all right? So you got Christianity, there's the Bible, and then we take the Bible, and then Christians do three things with what they find in the Bible. Here's we go. Number one,
there are three temptations, let's state it this way, that every Christian faces when we are confronted with Christianity. Now, when I'm going to say Christians, here are people who say, yes, I believe in Christ. Yes, I believe in the Word of God. And they make a profession of faith. Then they take that Christianity, and there's three temptations of what we do with Christianity, right? Number one is we, in a sense, remove what we don't like or what we disagree with. All right, there is the danger of basically removing it. So, okay, all right, well, Christianity seems to say this about marriage and divorce and remarriage. Well, we don't really like that. So churchianity will create an entire system where not only can you get a divorce, you can get remarried. All right, and you're not considered an adulterer. You can just be in the church. You can partake of the ordinances. You may be a Sunday school teacher. You may even be a pastor who's been divorced and remarried. You don't have to view as an adultery. You don't have to view about it. We all struggle, and you just move on. All right. So you know, we in a sense we take what the Bible may seem to indicate about divorce and remarriage, and we just kind of turn it into what we want. And it may require the throwing out things we don't like. If, for example, you'll see within Christianity, well, I know the Bible seems to indicate that only men can be pastors. Well, you know, let's throw that out because we don't like it. So there's we'll call this the temptation of subtraction or deletion. The temptation of deletion. Let's call it that. Every Christian, we're all faced with this temptation. You come into Christianity and the Bible says things that you're going to find yourself in conflict with. You're going to find yourself reading things in the Bible that condemns your feelings, your actions, your thoughts, and you're going to be tempted to go, well, you know, I gotta kind of change that a little bit. I don't think that really applies. So there is the deletion. There's the deletion temptation. Now, while some people delete, there's another group that sometimes comes in and they do addition, right? They add. Some people are deleting. Other people are,
what would we, inputting, let's put it that way. I was going to go with mathematical ideas. I think we'll go more computer ideas. You got some people sitting here hitting the delete key, delete, delete, delete. And you got other people, they're tapping away on their screen. They're typing on their keyboard and they're inputting things into Christianity. What do I mean by inputting? Let me give you some examples. And I could tell, we could spend 6 hours on this topic right here. We could spend 6 hours because I could just tell stories for 6 hours. It could be story time on Theology Central Podcast. Everyone gather around. It's time for another story. Let me tell you about all the things I encountered in Christianity that clearly someone was sitting at a keyboard and they were inputting into Christianity, all right? Let me give you an example. All right, so I become saved and a Southern Baptist Church right here in West Texas. In fact, the church is still there. It's First Baptist Church, Tuscola, Texas. You can look up Tuscola, Texas on a map. Yeah, it's not far from where I'm sitting currently in this church. It's about 2 miles, 2.5 miles down the road. That's where ultimately God saved me, inside a Southern Baptist church. And I became a Christian there, and that's where I started learning about Christianity. And it did not take long that I found myself in conflict with, again, I thought it was with Christianity, but it was with churchianity, because the church was sitting there inputting things into Christianity. Let me give you an example, all right? See if this makes sense to you. All right, I was told, in fact, before I even tell you what I was told, let me just tell you what happened. Because of my family situation, I wasn't living at home. Everything was bad. It's all crazy. Sad, sad story. Okay, we'll move on past all of that. But I ended up living in the parsonage of the church, right? They had a parsonage right next to the church, and nobody was living in it. And I think the church owned actually two houses. One, the pastor lived in. It was nicer. And then there was this older house right next to the church. And I was living in it. Now, when I was allowed to live in it, I was given no rules, no instructions, no, nothing. We didn't sit down and have a meeting, go, now you're going to be living in the church parsonage. Here's what we need of you. There was none of that, okay? So I move in. What do I bring with me? Anyone who knows me knows I absolutely love music. I brought in my stereo equipment, right? Because, well, I'm going to listen to music, right? No one told me I couldn't. So I'm listening to music one night. I'm listening to that very rebellious and sinful and over-the-top satanic album, Foreigner 4, right? I believe that's the name of the album, 4. It has the little 4 on it. So I believe it's Foreigner 4. The band is Foreigner. The name of the album is 4, right? I'm listening to it, right? I thought everything was going great, right? I'm listening to it. It's loud. Yes, it's loud. I'm a teenager at the time, right? Again, no one tells me I can't do anything. And so all of a sudden between like one song ends and then another, I hear this like, and I'm like, what is that? What is going on? Right. So I leave the room and I start walking over to the front door. And right when I get close to the front door, the front door has a glass, right? There's glass right there. There's like a curtain over it, but there's glass. All of a sudden, as I come walking, the glass shatters. Right. And I jump back. I'm like, what is going on? All of a sudden, the door flings open. This woman walks in, literally grabs me by my ear, pulls me out of the parsonage, and looks at me and says, "You cannot have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ listening to that kind of music." What just happened? It was the pastor's wife who was riding by on a bicycle, heard all of that, and proceeded to break the glass to pull me out by my ear to tell me that you cannot be a Christian and listen to Foreigner. I want you to hear that. You cannot be a Christian and listen to Foreigner. Now, I don't know where I find that in scripture. You cannot be saved. Like, if you put your faith in Jesus Christ, I'm sorry, that will not save you if you mix in Foreigner 4. If you mix in Foreigner, you cannot, this literally happened. Now, you think that should be enough to just run me off from Christianity. But so many things happened to me within Christianity that at times I don't know why I'm still a Christian. I think the reason I know I'm still a Christian is because I know there's a difference between churchianity and Christianity. There is a difference. This was churchianity. The church had inputted, you cannot be a Christian and listen to Foreigner. Now, basically, this is how it all developed. So I'll continue. It was a big situation. The pastor had to talk to me. It was crazy. So I had to basically say that, I'm sorry for listening to Foreigner. I will repent. Okay, yeah. So we won't go through the whole story. It's just crazy, right? But yeah, this is the crazy stuff that happened. In this church, here's what's been inputted into Christianity. You could not listen to secular music because that was worldly and ungodly. Now, please note, sometimes when they are inputting into Christianity, they will have a scripture to connect to it to try to make you think that they are inputting biblical ideas. But just look at how crazy this is. So I cannot listen to secular music because that was unchristian. I can only listen to Christian music. But here's what's interesting. I went to that pastor's house. I'm at the pastor's house. They have a television on. They're watching a movie. That movie was secular. Okay, let me get this right. Okay, I can't listen to secular music, but I can watch secular television. The secular movie had obscenity, so I can watch secular movies. I can watch secular movies with secular secular movies with obscenity, but I cannot listen to secular music. And then here is the one that really just drives me insane. The youth group went to Hardin Simmons, and we were having some activity. Hardin Simmons is one of the Southern Baptist colleges here in this town, Southern Baptist University. And we went there, and I don't know, we were like the student center, and we were having these activities. And guess what the young people were doing? Are you ready for this? They were watching Footloose. Now, wait a minute. Footloose is filled with secular music, right? We could go through Kenny Loggins, the theme to Footloose. I Hear It for the Boys. Is that Denise Williams? I think Quiet Riot shows up in there. We could go on. Bonnie Taylor. I think she's on there. I'm trying to think of all the songs on the soundtrack for Footloose. But, okay, there's... So wait a minute. But I could not listen to secular music. So Foreigner 4, bad. Footloose, good. And Footloose would be more, there would be more philosophical problems with Footloose. It makes no sense. But it was the weird world that I found myself that basically I could not listen to secular music. And you could not dance. You could not go to dances. Dancing was a no. You cannot have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ and dance. But then they watch Footloose, which made an argument that you could dance. So I don't even understand what it was. This weird world of what? Inputting. Then I finally leave Texas. Whew, getting out of this mess. Okay, I'll go to Nebraska. Okay, there's got to be some sane. Oh, no. Because this was some disease of churchianity. When I get to the Independent Fundamental Baptist Church, I end up in Papillion, Nebraska. Here are the rules that were given to me there. Okay. Rule number one, if I was going to do any ministry in the church or anything, I always had to wear a tie. Because you know what's right there in the book of, I don't know, but you did not wear a tie, you were in trouble. You had to wear a tie. Women could not wear pants. Let me see what else. Oh, you could not go to the movie theater. You could not go to the movie theater because that made you worldly. Now, here's what's crazy. I couldn't go to the movie theater, but I could go to the video rental store and rent whatever I want. Now, you figured that out. I can't figure that out. Could not go to the movie theater. That was sinful. But I could rent all the movies I wanted. Let me give you an example. So you couldn't go to the movie theater, but one day we were over at the pastor's house, and I think the pastor's son or somebody was talking about how they had watched JFK. I think Kevin Costner was in JFK. I believe. I can't remember who starred in it. All right. And, the whole thing about the JFK assassination and conspiracy. I think Oliver Stone directed it. You get it. All right. So One of my friends, we were like, wait a minute. So we can't go to the movie theater, but we could go rent JFK. And so we rented it, and my friend rented it. I was at work, and he sat down with a notebook and wrote down how many times the F word was used in JFK. And I think he got to like this is a long time ago, so my numbers may be right, but it was, I think, over 100 times. And he's like, so let me get this right. We can't go to a movie theater, but we can go rent a movie that uses the F word over 100 times. He's like, this makes no sense. Oh, but to add to this, guess what we could not, guess what else we could not do? You cannot listen to secular music, because again, that's worldly. So I can't listen to secular music, but I can listen to a movie that uses the F word over 100 times. That makes a lot of sense. Oh, guess what? I could not even listen to contemporary Christian music, because that was worldly and fleshly. But guess what I could do? I could sit on Saturday and watch 18 hours of college football, and I'm okay. College football, good. Contemporary Christian music, bad. I could give example after example after example. The pastor's son got into a major conflict with his parents, and he brought me into the middle of it. Because here's this. Are you ready for this? They could own all of the Rocky movies. They could watch the Rocky movies as many times as they wanted to. But guess what he could not own? He bought the soundtrack, I think, to Rocky III, which I think had Eye of the Tiger. I believe it was Rocky III. By Survivor, if I remember correctly. Yeah, and I know who the band who did the song. I think it was that soundtrack. It may have been Rocky IV. Who knows? But it was one of the Rocky soundtracks. Now, he gets caught with the Rocky soundtrack. His dad destroys the soundtrack, says he cannot own the soundtrack because it's worldly. But he's like, that doesn't make any sense because I can I own the movie. So you can listen to the music and the... What in the world is that? That is the addition. That is the inputting. So we have the deleting and the inputting. The deleting and the inputting. The deleting and the inputting. These are two major issues. Then we have a third thing that happens in churchianity. We'll call this the introduction of a virus. All right. So we have the subtraction or the deleting and the inputting. Now, the inputting is you're trying to input. Now, I want to make it very clear. The people who input things into Christianity, most of the times their motives are really good and pure, right? They've got scripture like, okay, well, I'm not to be fleshly. I'm not to be worldly. And they really are trying. The problem is the scriptures don't say and justify what they are inputting. They're going beyond the scriptures. They're adding to it. Think of the Pharisees, right? The Sadducees, in a sense, were the people who were deleting. They're the ones who were deleting. The Sadducees were. And then the Pharisees were the one who were doing the addition. Now, their motives were right. They wanted to keep people following God's law, but they just kept adding more and more rules, more and more rules that went beyond God's law. Well, that's what. So the people who input, their motives are good. You want to respect what they're trying to do. They want godliness and holiness, but usually it just turns into large amounts of hypocrisy, all right? It's crazy. But then there are those who introduce a virus, right? Usually I'm going to follow the computer idea. They introduce a virus. Now, they introduce a virus, and they bring something into Christianity that doesn't belong into Christianity. We see this with the political hijacking of the American church. Politics have been introduced into the church, and then it corrupts the church. And now, it corrupts Christianity, and it creates this churchianity thing, where now, is that Christianity? No, that's some politically hijacked mutant that tries to claim Christianity, but it's all political. It introduces some virus into it that begins to corrupt it. It may introduce pragmatism. It may introduce, you know, some kind of new church growth movement. You get the idea. It introduces a virus. Those are three temptations every Christian has to deal with: the deleting, the inputting, and the introduction of a virus. Now, we could talk more about the introducing of a virus, but we don't have time. Now, I say all of that because now we have this subject here that a listener has brought to our attention: tattoos. Now, guess what we don't want to do? We don't want to delete anything Scripture says. We don't say, well, you know what? I want tattoos. I like tattoos. The Bible says that. Delete it. At the same time, we don't want to input some rule and some regulation and impose it on people that's not really there. So we want to avoid these temptations, okay? So what do we do with tattoos? Now, there was a time that I think tattoos were seen as extreme. Now, depending on where you are, there was a time, I think, if someone walked into the church or claimed to be a Christian and they got a tattoo, people would be like, oh, what are you doing? Tattoos were seen as somewhat rebellious, countercultural, but now they're just pretty much like, whatever. Like, they're pretty much everywhere now. It's like, who cares, right? So, but should that impact how we view it? We have to view it from a scriptural standpoint. So what do we do with this? Well, I'm not going to reinvent the wheel here or pretend like that I am, you know, smarter than anyone else. I'm going to pull up a discussion here about tattoos, all right? Now, there's about 9,000 articles online and about this subject. I'm going to be referring to one found at BibleStudyTools.com. I'm going to be referring to an article there. I'm going to be kind of using some of it, and you'll know when I'm reading and when I'm not, and see what they have to say in regards to tattoos. Now, one thing I do find interesting, there seems to be pretty much universal agreement to the verse that everyone goes to, and it seems to be pretty much universal agreement about the historical context surrounding that verse. So that is pretty comforting to me. It's one thing when nobody can agree, but if everyone agrees on these basic facts, then I think we should be able to figure out, okay, what does the Bible say about tattoo? Let's not delete, let's not input, and let's see if we can come up with an answer, all right? Now, the verse that almost everyone goes to is Leviticus chapter 19, verse 28. Leviticus chapter 19, verse 28. Now let me read it. Leviticus chapter 19, verse 28. You shall not make any cuttings. Okay, my Bible has it broken down here. All right, because I have to turn a page here. Right, Leviticus 19, 28. So let's read this correctly. You shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead, nor print any marks upon you. I am the Lord. Okay. Before we even look at Leviticus 19:28, there's a couple of things we have to stop and ask ourselves. Now, wait a minute. We're in the book of Leviticus, okay? Now, if you've read the book of Leviticus, there's a lot of rules and a lot of laws, and I bet you don't follow a large percentage of them, all right? There are all kinds of laws and rules offered up in Leviticus that you do not follow. Now, the question is, which ones do I follow and which ones do I not follow, and who makes the rules of the ones I follow and the ones I do not follow? Now, some of them, hopefully, you can figure out relatively quick. There's all kinds of rules in Leviticus about sacrifices. Now, we would argue we no longer engage in sacrifices because the once and final sacrifice occurred with Jesus Christ. He was the final complete once and for all sacrifice that all the other sacrifices were pointing to. All right. I think we agree with that. All right. Then there's a lot of, we'll call them ceremonial laws about feast, and you got to do this on this day. You got to do this on this day. And I think we believe that those ceremonial laws were also pointing to Christ. So the Christ fulfilled the sacrificial and ceremonial laws. And so we are free from those. I think you would also agree that there's a lot of laws here telling Israel how they should conduct themselves and what they should do, and we usually refer to those as civil laws, and that those civil laws do not apply to us because they were for Israel. Now, there is a category that some people will refer to as moral laws, and we'll say those moral laws are still binding on us. Now, those moral laws were ultimately designed to show us that we cannot ultimately keep them and we need Jesus Christ. So the laws are, so we have to realize that these laws are there to condemn us and to reveal our sin, and that we are trusting in Christ and Christ alone for our salvation, not in our keeping of the law, but in the fact that Christ kept it for us. But we do believe any moral law is something we are to pursue and try to follow. So when it comes to a tattoo, is this a moral law, or was this a law that has a very specific historical setting that does no longer applies to us as far as tattoos are concerned? Now, as soon as I go to Leviticus 19:28, let me just show you how crazy it is. Just go the verse before, all right? Let's go to verse 26. You shall not eat anything with the blood, neither shall you use enchantment nor observe times. All right, so wait a minute. I'm not to eat anything with blood. Now, I know people who eat steak, and let's just say they eat, I'm here in Texas, so a lot of people eat steak, and some people eat steak, and I hate to say this, they eat their steak in such a way that when you stick your fork in it, it moves, right? In fact, you stick your fork in it, it moves off the plate. Now, I know that's a little hyperbole. I'm saying that they eat it medium rare. I mean, it's pink. You see, it makes me sick. I can't even understand that. No, I'm not a big steak person. I will eat it, but it's got to be well done. I don't want any concept of blood anywhere connected with it, right? But does that violate that? Not a lot of people, well, no, it doesn't really. Well, that's dietary laws. The dietary laws were done away with, so that one doesn't count. That one doesn't count. Okay, that one doesn't count. We'll say the dietary laws are done away with. Well, that makes sense because we could argue the dietary laws are clearly done away with in the New Testament. All right, fine. All right, so the eating anything with blood, the dietary laws doesn't count. All right, what about the next one? Verse 27, you shall not round the corners of your heads, neither shall thou mar the corners of thy beard. Now, this is dealing with hair and beard. Now, do we need to follow this rule? Is this rule done away with in the New Testament? Magically, just whoop, gone. All right, do I have to have a beard? Because I don't. No beard. I shave. I cut my hair. Now, if you look at this verse and other translations, it reads like this. Leviticus 19:27. Do not cut the hair at the sides of your head or clip off the edges of your beard. Do not trim off the hair on your temples or trim your beards. You should not round off the hair on your temples nor mar the edges of your beard. Well, this seems to imply that I have to have a beard and I can't trim it. Okay, so does that count? Now, most people say, no, that doesn't count. Well, wait a minute. If that doesn't count, why? Is that a ceremonial law? It's not a dietary law. Is that, okay. So most people will say, nope, that one doesn't count. And then all of a sudden we come to look at verse 30, you shall keep my Sabbaths and reverence my sanctuary. Well, most people say, well, nope, the Sabbath law doesn't count. So I'm all confused. Now, some people will say the Sabbath law counts, but then they'll say the beard trimming and that doesn't count. And the eating with blood doesn't count. We pick and choose here. There's a lot of picking and choosing. So a lot of people who has no intention of following probably 99.9% of the rules laid out in Leviticus or Deuteronomy, Numbers, or anywhere else in the Old Testament, they aren't going to follow any of those, will come along and go, there we have it. No tattoos. Because Leviticus chapter 19, verse 28. I mean, they won't quite say it that way like it's a movie trailer, but you get the idea. They're going like, that's it. You can't have tattoos. And you're like, well, wait a minute. What about all the other verses and all the other rules? Well, that one doesn't count. That one does. Yeah, because you've got your finger on the delete key. Isn't it amazing? You can delete, 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 input, input, input. No tattoos. Is Leviticus 19:28 about you sitting in your house and you're like, you know what? I need a tattoo on this arm. I need a tattoo here. Let me go to the, let me look up, well-reviewed, hopefully healthy tattoo parlor. Let me go there and let's get a tattoo. Nope. You're in violation of Leviticus 19. Now, if you're in violation of Leviticus 19, well, then you have to ask yourself, first, am I in violation of it? And two, is that still applicable, right? And you should really ask that question. Now, let me, for full transparency, I have no tattoos. I have no desire to get a tattoo, don't want a tattoo, have no, a couple of reasons. One, I'm putting a permanent mark on my body that what if I change my mind 30 minutes later? That's number one. Number two, I know this is really weird thing that happens. You get older, and when you get older, your body changes. So you may get a couple of tattoos on your arm that look really good when you're 25. What are they going to look like when you're 65? What are they going to look like when you're 55? They're not going to have that same vibe of cool. They're not going to have that. They're going to look kind of like, it doesn't look right. It doesn't look as good. Now, maybe for some people, it will look just as good. For other people, it is. And so you look at me, I don't look like a tattoo kind of person. So I've never gotten one, never desired to get one. Not only that, I wouldn't want to spend the money on one, right? Like for me, if I'm going to spend money, I'm not going to spend money so someone can take a needle and draw a picture on my skin. No, I'm going to use the money for something that I would be more drawn to. Like, you know, well, music would be one. I love music, music equipment, right? I love good stereo equipment, a good pair of headphones. I mean, hey, you know, if you ever want to donate to my music equipment fund, by all means, send me a check, right? I mean, there's equipment I want that costs thousands of dollars and I can't get it because I don't have any money. So, but if I'm going to spend money, I'm not going to be drawing on myself. It's just, no, or having someone else draw on me. I don't get it, right? So, but, you know, if I was going to spend money, if I wanted to make myself look different, I would just spend it on, I don't know, a new hairstyle, a new pair, some more clothing, you know, a new outfit. That makes more sense than ink on my body. I don't get it. But that's okay. Other people, they would rather spend money putting ink on their body than new clothes. Or maybe they want new clothes and ink on their body, whatever the case may be. But guess what? This is very important. It's a very important thing. You cannot, and I stress this if I don't lose my voice, you cannot allow your personal preferences to be infused into your interpretation of Scripture. You see this with parents all the time. I don't like your music. It's ungodly and it's worldly. Because right here, do not love the world. Do not love the world. You can't listen to that. I don't like your music. All right? Now, hey, mom, dad, shh. We're trying to watch this movie. And then the kid's looking at the movie going, that's not worldly and fleshly? So you can't take, just because you don't like it. Look, for example, I despise The Lord of the Rings. I cannot stand the books. I can't stand the movies. I can't stand The Hobbit. I can't stand any of that. It drives me crazy. And it drives me crazy mainly because Christians elevate it to like it's, you know, you've got Scripture and then you've got The Lord of the Rings. And I'm like, no. And it's like, and I hate when Christians almost act like, you're a Christian and you don't like Lord of the Rings? Oh, and I'm like, and I want to say, and you're a Christian and you don't like this album and you don't like the, no, but Lord of the Rings, it's a Christian allegory. You have to like it. It's like, when did it become Scripture that I have to like it? But just because I don't like it, I'm not going to sit there and go, well, you know what? And the Lord of the Rings, you have wizards and you have magic and you have walking trees and I've got Scripture here about the condemning anything associated with magic. Okay, I'm going to condemn it. I'm not going to use my personal preference and then try to find a Scripture to. No, I'm not going to get into all of that. I'm not going to do that. You can't use your. You have a personal preference and you find Scripture to justify your personal preference. So here is. I don't like tattoos. I don't get it. Don't understand it. But what does Scripture say? Already we know we're in shaky ground. We're in shaky ground, right? Because Leviticus 19 falls into verses that nobody even follows. So what do we do here? Well, let's look at Leviticus 19, 28 carefully. I think from the verse, we get a little bit of a hint. You shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead. All right, immediately we're like, okay, something's going on here, right? This cutting, this putting ink on their bodies, there's something going on here that we need insight into. Remember, when we read the Bible, we're reading verses written to specific people living in specific historical context, and sometimes those words have a very specific application that really doesn't have much of an application for us. So what is going on here? Well, there seems to be universal agreement. There seems to be universal agreement, and I'm going to borrow from this article here. All right? Leviticus 19:28 literally translates, and a cutting for the dead you will not make in your flesh, and writing marks you will not make on you. I am the Lord. The word writing refers to inscribed or engraved symbols, words, and is used only here. The words for marks, also used here alone, has an uncertain root, so we're not really sure what the word means. Further, the word tattoo did not enter into the English language until the late 1700s. This is probably why the KJV, written in the early 1600s, is closer to the literal translation saying, "You shall not print marks upon you." The background of this law was that Israel, after being rescued from slavery, was between Egypt and Canaan. Recent archaeological discoveries indicates that while Egypt did tattoos, it was limited to women. Evidence suggests that tattooing the body parts of women associated with fertility, and then they would do certain parts of the body, was believed to be a good luck charm to protect the birthing process. And Canaan, evidence indicates that instead of marking the body with ink, more extreme sacrification measures like branding, slashing, or gashing the skin were used. Archaeology, backed by biblical text, indicates that Canaanites would customarily slash their bodies for ritualistic purposes. You can see this in 1 Kings chapter 18, I believe verse 28. They would especially do this to mourn their dead and honor their gods. Leviticus 19:28 seems to imply this when it says, "You will not make cuttings in your flesh for the dead, nor print marks on you." In light of this information from Egypt and Canaan, it would seem God was forbidding sacrification, not tattooing, as we know it. All right? With that said, while there may be no clear passage in the Bible addressing tattoos, this is hardly a license for unrestrained tattooing. All right, so then they go through and try to come up with a solution. Well, let me just make it very clear. If this text is dealing with, hey, basically don't follow these practices, Israel, that these other nations are doing in regards to slashing and hurting and cutting themselves for some religious purpose or to show some dedication to their God, you don't need to do that. The Christian God, or at that particular time, the God of the Jews, the God of Israel, is not asking you to cut and harm and mark yourself for them. And we don't remember the dead by cutting ourselves and doing that kind of thing, or putting symbols and images on ourselves. It's clearly trying to draw a distinction. If you think about this, most of the laws that God gives Israel is to make them a distinct nation from the culture around them. Now, some would argue, well, doesn't that apply then? Hey, look, if you get a tattoo, are you not looking like the culture around you? Okay, let's say that's true. If I get a tattoo, I'm looking at the culture around me. Let's say that's true. Okay, how far do we take that? Do we wear similar clothing? Do we have similar haircuts? Do we not have, usually in many cases, engage in similar entertainment? How far do we take this? Clearly, a tattoo today does not have any of the connotation that what is being talked about in Leviticus. People get marks on their bodies for all, images on their bodies for all kinds. They think it's a cool design, or it's to represent this, it's to represent that. People do it for all kinds of reasons, all right? So I don't think you can draw Leviticus 19:28 to modern day tattooing. I don't think you can. I just don't think it can. Now, some may try to use the argument, well, wait a minute, you're acting like the world, you're looking like the world. Okay, before we get to tattoos, let's look at all the other issues where you could be accused of looking like the world and acting like the world. Where do you draw that? To me, the issue is when I'm not to be like the world, I'm not to think like the world, I'm not to have the same morality, I'm not to have the same worldview, I am to think differently. Now, yes, I am to act differently, but it's acting differently and clearly what's clearly identified in Scripture about, like, okay, I love my enemy. I don't hate my enemy. I don't seek vengeance. You know, I have love, joy, peace, long-suffering. Morality is different. There's very tangible ways. We always want to reduce it to the most simplistic and surface level. Okay, ooh, they watch a movie, and okay, I'm not going to watch the same movie. Okay, well, then you're not going to watch any movies? Like, we try to make it this surface level stuff. The difference goes to deeper things than these surface level things. I'm not saying the surface level things may not be important. I'm just saying when it comes to a tattoo, I don't have a tattoo. You know what? I've worked with people, been around people who have tattoos. You know what? They don't care. They don't go, well, why don't you have a tattoo? Tell me why your body has no tattoo. I've never been anywhere going, why don't you have a tattoo? Well, you see, I'm a Christian. Oh, that explains it. You Christians don't have tattoos. Nobody notices. Nobody cares. Now, if I was in a situation where the whole world got a tattoo and Christians were the only people who didn't, then maybe. But nobody, I think, pays attention to who has a tattoo and who doesn't have a tattoo. I don't pay attention to. I don't pull up at a drive-thru at a fast food restaurant and look and go, oh, look, she has a tattoo on her arm. I could care less if she has 20 tattoos, 30 tattoos, 50 tattoos. I don't care. It makes no difference to me. It's irrelevant to me. And I've never seen one of them going, oh, wait a minute, you don't have a tattoo on any of your arms. But no, I don't think they care. I don't think I care. I don't think anybody cares. Right? So I think right there, it doesn't really work. I know we want to draw that correlation, but you got to be careful, because if you're going to say, well, you can't get a tattoo, you look like it the world, you got to take that all the way then. Then you can't do this, you can't do that, and you're going to create a list of 5,000 rules about what you can and cannot do, and you're going back to inputting things in the scripture. The prohibition here seems clearly that if I'm in a culture, right, where if I get a tattoo, it's because I'm worshiping a certain God, okay, then I'm not getting the tattoo. If I have to cut my flesh to dim, if it had a religious theological implication, then by all means don't do so. Like, so maybe some cultures you would want to avoid getting a tattoo, right? And listen, if you're in a situation, so right there, we'll get to that. We'll get to that in a minute. All right, we'll get to that in a minute. So I don't think it's the same, right? And anyway, some may argue and try to quote the passage about, well, your body is the temple of the living God. How dare you treat your body that way? Now, I've heard Christians come across all sanctimonious that way. I've seen preachers standing behind the pulpit saying, you do not get a tattoo. It's the body is the temple of God. It's not yours to mark up. It's God's temple. And it preaches good. But a lot of times the people up there screaming behind the pulpit, I look and I'm like, you're probably 100 pounds overweight. So what about you taking care of the temple? I've been to lunch with you. You're cramming enough garbage into your body. I don't know if you can be yelling at me about the temple, right? That kid's got a tattoo. He runs 7 miles a day, eats as clean as he possibly can. Blood pressure, great. Cholesterol levels, great. Is he really doing damage to the temple and you're yelling at him and your cholesterol is like 9,000? You're basically beyond pre-diabetic. You're post-diabetic. You're going to be in diabetic coma in the next 13 seconds. All right. So you've got diabetes, high cholesterol, and you're overweight and you're going to yell at people and you're shoving 8 Big Macs down your throat while you're yelling at people about getting a tattoo because it's the temple of God. You see, what's easy? Don't get a tattoo because that's the temple of God. See, that's easy to go after. We always go after the surface level things. Well, okay, well, if you're going to yell at that, then what are you doing about taking care of the temple of God? Do you exercise? Do you do push-ups, crunches, sit-ups? Do you run? Do you do cardio? You're getting your heart rate above a certain level for 20 minutes, 3 times, 4 times a day, a week. What are you doing? What's your weight? Those things require great work and effort. It's easy to just yell at the people with the tattoos. So I think that is crazy. I think that is crazy. So here's what I would say. Someone wants to get a tattoo. I would just, and these are just basic questions I would ask him. Why do you want to get a tattoo? Have you really thought about it? Do you realize your body's going to change, right? Obviously, what you do place on your body, that matters. I mean, you know, if you can't be a Christian and get a tattoo that says Satan is Lord, I think we could all agree with that. You don't want to get something that's inappropriate, that's, you know, not correct. I think that you have to think about it. And I think most importantly, now this is where some Christians will get mad. Whatever we do as Christians, whatever we do as Christians, nobody likes this. We have to remember a very important rule. We are not to do anything that would cause someone to stumble. Remember, in 1 Corinthians, they had a problem. There was meat that had been offered unto idols that was being sold in the marketplace. Hey, this meat's been offered unto idols. Now we'll sell it in the marketplace. Maybe we sell it at a discount. Christians would buy that meat. And some people are like, oh, you're eating meat that was offered unto an idol. You're going back to idolatry. What are you doing? And Paul said, hey, if eating meat causes someone to stumble, then you don't eat that meat. You give up your right. Sometimes as a Christian, we have to give up our rights. So if you go to a church and everyone there, for some weird reason, is greatly offended by tattoos, then either you're going to have to find a new church in the most respectful way, don't cause World War III. But if that church teaches good doctrine and theology, then you know what? Just don't get a tattoo. Now, I've had to live with this as well. I've been in situations where I could not listen to the music I wanted to listen to and do certain things because it was going to cause major problems and stuff. I gave up my rights. Now, I didn't always handle myself correctly. Sometimes I got bitter. Sometimes I got rebellious. Sometimes I didn't handle, but I tried my best. Like, okay, oh, you know, like if let's say you came to my church and you're like, hey, let's go out to eat. And so I'm going to pick you up and I'm listening to music and I pull up at your driveway. I'm going to turn the music off. Because I don't know if you get in that car, if that music's going to offend you or not offend you. Now, when you get out of my car, I may go back and listen to it. But tattoo, now, or if you do get a tattoo in church, just keep it covered. That's an easy thing to do. Just keep it covered, and then you don't cause any problems in the church. I don't believe it's incorrect. I don't believe it's wrong to get a tattoo. I don't think the scripture here really is working on that. Now, I will say, if you're a pastor and you're trying to get tattoos just to make yourself look hip and cool or relevant, I think that's crazy as well. I think that's crazy as well. My job as a pastor is not to try to be hip and cool. My job is to just teach the scriptures. So you always got to go to motivations, but I can't judge anyone's motivations. I just think Leviticus 19:28 is not really about that. I'm going to do one thing here. I didn't even think about this, but then I just noticed I have a Bible dictionary here. I don't know if they even have an entry in here about tattoos. I doubt they do, but if they do, and again, if you go to a Bible dictionary, they don't even have an entry about the subject, probably because the Bible says very little about it. All right, let's see here. Oh, no, tattoo. All right, here's what it says. They do have a thing. A tattoo, a permanent mark or design fixed upon the body by a process of pricking the skin and inserting a color under the skin, all right? The moral and ceremonial laws of Leviticus declare you shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead, nor tattoo any marks upon you, Leviticus 19:28. Now, they refer to it as a ceremonial and a moral law. They try to apply it to as a moral law. Any kind of self-laceration or marking of the body was prohibited among the Hebrew people. Such cutting was associated with pagan cults that tattooed their followers while they mourned the dead. Please note, that's the issue. You were looking like a member of a pagan cult. Well, if tattoos today made you look like you're a member of a pagan cult, then by all means, don't get one. If you find yourself in a culture where that tattoo... I think the prohibition there is more along those lines, and I don't think it's applicable to the tattoo culture of today, which, I mean, who doesn't have a tattoo? I mean, literally. I mean, you see tattoos everywhere. You see people 60 tattoos, 40 tattoos. I mean, I'm waiting for a six-year-old to walk up with a tattoo. Everyone has tattoos. So it doesn't demonstrate religious affiliation, does not demonstrate theology, does not demonstrate atheism, Christianity. It's just people like to mark their bodies for whatever reason, and I don't see an issue with it. I put it this way: there are deeper issues that I think as Christians we struggle with that goes well beyond tattoos. Well, like, again, we always like to go after the surface level things. We do. We like, you know, okay, don't watch this movie, don't do this, don't do that. And in many cases, we may not be watching a movie, we may not have a tattoo, we may be wearing a tie, but then we are filled with hatred and we're backbiting, gossiping, slandering, not demonstrating any love, we're ungodly in 15,000 other ways. Sometimes we like these surface level things because they're easy things to make us feel righteous. They're easy things to make us feel good. I mean, the Pharisees always wanted to point out all of the surface level things that they were doing, right? I mean, look at how much we tithe. Look at we pray. Look at how godly we are. The Pharisees love to point out all of the how righteous they are, but then look what was really going on inside of them. They were dirty cups. Sometimes we want to clean up the outside of the cup and not having a tattoo thinking we're great. Now, listen, I'm not saying we shouldn't worry about the outside, because we should. I'm just saying that I don't think a tattoo is the issue. I think we're taking this scripture and reading far more into it, far more into it. And again, we're ignoring the scriptures right around it. And does the New Testament bring up the issue of tattooing? So, now, by all means, I never know if you're a teenager and your parent says no, then no is the answer and you accept it and you deal with it, right? In a respectful, godly way. Once you leave home, then if you want to get a tattoo, then you need to think about it. Make sure you know why. Now, if you're doing it out of rebellion, well, my mom never said I could get a tattoo. I'm going to get a tattoo today. Well, now you're just doing it to prove that's, you don't want to mark your body permanently, but try to prove a point. Okay. You know, if you're in a church that says, don't get a tattoo, and you just want to make a point, so you're going to go out and get a tattoo just to show them. Now that goes with the deep, that's rebellion, all right? If you're in a church and they don't want you to get a tattoo, can what's more important? You're marking your body or trying to keep unity in the church, trying to be godly, trying to glorify God? So sometimes you got to choose what's more important to you. Now, there's times in my life, what was more important to me was music. And sometimes the church. I'm just going to be honest with you. I've struggled. Look, I don't have an issue with tattoos, but I've struggled with my own issues where I find myself in churchianity with all these rules. We just want to, I'm not saying those rules are acceptable. I'm not saying those rules are right, but sometimes that's the best church situation you can find yourself. So then you got to do what you can to try to make it better and try to bring God glory. All right. I'm going to stop right there. I don't know if this answered your question. I tried my best. If it did not, email me at newsif@yahoo.com. newsif@yahoo.com. That's newsif@yahoo.com. And say, man, that was hot garbage. What are you doing? Can you try again? And I will try again, right? Okay. But newsif@yahoo.com. And for anyone else, if you want a long answer, email me, because as you notice, we've been an hour, because I usually take an hour to answer the smallest question. All right. But there you go. So a lot to think about. The main thing I want you to just understand, churchianity and Christianity, two very different things. And sometimes churchianity does a lot of deleting, inputting, and introducing viruses. Sometimes you got to go, okay, what does the Bible say? And then try to figure that out. All right. I'll stop right there. Everyone have a great day. God bless.